Good morning or early afternoon. It is my distinct honor to be part of this very distinguished group of speakers for the symposium and to hear very intelligent questions from the audience. Obviously, these are tough diseases, but if nothing else, before I go into the discussion of the clinical picture and trajectory of the disease, I really want to reinforce what the speakers have been talking about in the morning, that there is tremendous science and the horizon is very positive. And with that said, I was asked to cover the spectrum of the clinical manifestations, focusing on PSP, and then approach to management of PSP, pharmacological, and as you've heard, unfortunately, there are not that many options as of today, and I will be really focusing on supportive care and the goal of improvement of the quality of life. With that said, Dr. Beauvais, in his very succinct summary of the research studies going on in PSP, he has already alluded to the fact that PSP was first described by three physicians, a team of the clinicians and pathologists who gave the very specific clinical pathological description of the syndrome in 1963 that now carries the name of Steele, Richardson, Olszewski. And these are the pictures from the original publication. And they very insightfully have said that most likely the spectrum of the phenotype, and phenotype is the clinical picture of the disease, will expand with the expansion of our knowledge. And that's a lot that I will be also talking about today. But before we get into that, just to get to the basics and to get everyone to the same level, PSP and CPD belongs to the category of the diseases that generically are described as Parkinson's plus syndromes. So what they have in common is presence of syndrome of Parkinsonism. Parkinsonism is a syndrome. It's description of the clinical features. It's not a clinical diagnosis. And these are the clinical symptoms that feed into the syndrome of Parkinsonism. Resting tremor, which is very characteristic of Parkinson's disease, but distinctly uncommon, the classical resting tremor for patients with PSP or CBD, rigidity, which is stiffness of the muscles, which again, in Parkinson's, carries a very distinct picture of cogwheel rigidity, increased tone, akinesia, which is lack of movement, of bradykinesia, which is slowness of movement, and postural instability, which really is a sine qua non of the features seen in people with PSP. So that is the syndrome. And now, what are the most common conditions that present with that syndrome? Some of you have said that at the beginning, you were given the you or your family members were given the diagnosis of Parkinson's disease until the right diagnosis was arrived to. And the reason for that, because epidemiologically, if you look at all the patients that we see in our clinic with the clinical features of Parkinsonism, 75% of them will have diagnosis of idiopathic Parkinson's disease. So that is the most common clinical diagnosis that presents with that syndrome. So now we are moving from the syndrome, which is constellation of the symptoms, to the specific clinical entities. So idiopathic Parkinson's disease, right? Then whenever a student comes into our clinic, we always highlight, look for symptomatic causes. Look for anything that could have been a trigger because those potentially could be reversible. And that's again, much more the discussion relevant to people with Parkinson's disease because there is a set of drugs that can cause a syndrome, clinical features indistinguishable from the true neurodegenerative condition. And then the category that we lump together under neurodegenerative conditions. And that's where PSP resides, that's where CBD resides, that's where MSA resides. And then there is always a wastebasket, quote unquote. Syndrome, conditions that present with syndrome that we just cannot put in specific category until, unfortunately, the pathologist gives us the correct diagnosis. So what are the most common, this is not all-inclusive list, of neurodegenerative conditions aside from Parkinson's disease that present with features of Parkinsonism? And progressive supranuclear palsy is at the top of the list because as much as uncommon that is, it is the most common entity in that list. Corticobasal degeneration is there, diffuse Lewy body disease, multiple system atrophy should be listed there. So this is the overview. Now let's get into the clinical spectrum of the symptoms seen in people with progressive supranuclear palsy. And again, to this audience, I don't need to tell you. Majority of you live this or have lived it with your family members or people living with the disease. But these are the clinical features that are most characteristically seen in people with the classical presentation of PSP. And we'll talk more about that. Age of onset above the age of 40. We talked about the fact that for majority of patients, it is a sporadic disease. Sporadic means that it doesn't run in the family, but there is a small percent of people, as was clearly alluded in the morning, who do have genetic cause for the disease, and those families are extremely important to us because we can learn a lot on small proportion that potentially could be applied to the population at large. So progressive course, Parkinsonism we talked about, severe postural instability is sine qua non, again, of the classical syndrome. Supranuclear gaze palsy sounds very complicated, but it's in a bit specifically failure or difficulty to have the ability to spontaneously look down. And the reason why it is called supranuclear, because there is no problem with the nuclei that are driving that. So it's the signal that goes from that nuclei, you've seen those pictures of midbrain, up into the further connections. Speech problems, dysarthria, dysphagia, so swallowing problems. This is kind of the broad description of the syndrome. You've already seen the numbers of the prevalence. They're posted on the CurePSP flyer out there. So these are the numbers quoted in most of the literature on the prevalence. So prevalence is how common the condition is cross-sectionally in the population. So obviously a rare disease. The typical age of onset is in mid-60s, and I'll show you more data on that. But obviously, as in any condition, there is a large spectrum of the age. And ultimate diagnosis, as you've heard again and again in, during the morning, is pathology-based. So pathologist is the only person who can make definitive diagnosis of these conditions. And that's why participation in the brain banks is so essential. And I really cannot go beyond without really putting the pitch. It's a gift from the patients. It is tremendous input to the science. That's how we learn. And all of us participating in the care of people with these conditions are very accustomed and comfortable to start those conversations very early in the disease. Not because we are the black ravens bringing the bad news, but because it really is part of the overall discussion with a person and with the families. And as indicated on the slide, and as you've heard today in the morning, ultimately it's pathology diagnosis where a pathologist looks for the presence of tau, specifically for repeat tau in specific areas of the brain, and confirms the clinical diagnosis. And these are the some of the still pictures of some of the patients in my practice. I purposefully did not include the videos. Again, this audience does not need the video description of the patients, but what is distinctly, and that's the reason why Dr. Bave has said that for physicians who are comfortable with the diagnosis, making the diagnosis of the classical syndrome is pretty straightforward because of very specific features for the disease. But unfortunately, it's not that easy. And the reason why it's not that easy, because there is a large spectrum of clinical manifestations that go outside of that classical presentation. So I first will review the original diagnostic criteria that were put forth by the National Institute of Neurological Disorders, NINDS, in 1996, and the group was led by the effort of Irene Litvan, who really has made and continues to make tremendous contribution to the family of the diseases of atypical Parkinsonian syndromes. And these are the criteria that were put forth. So first of all, there is distinction in possible, probable, so the higher from possible, less confidence, to probable, higher confidence, and the highest level of confidence that the clinician can give aside from the pathology proof. And definitive diagnosis, we already talked about it, so I'm not going to dwell on that. And these diagnostic criteria have been very specific, meaning that if you see those features, there will be a high probability that the pathologist will confirm your diagnosis, but low specific, but low sensitivity. And sensitivity means that we were missing a lot of patients who ultimately turned out to have pathology diagnosis of PSP for the reason that their spectrum of clinical presentation was outside of the classical. And for that reason, actually, under the auspice of the Movement Disorder Society, the diagnostic criteria for progressive supranuclear palsy have just been published. Actually, this publication is not even in print yet. It has appeared in electronic before print publication of Movement Disorders, so very, very recent, very significant effort. And you can see how tremendous the effort was. So the group was charged with reviewing the publications for PSP from 1996 to 2015. They identified 5,900 articles, of which 462 were reviewed at least at the level of the abstracts, and they also that included a review of the largest autopsy confirmed cases of 200 plus brains in the autopsy, and compared to the other brains with other neurodegenerative conditions in the family. And you've seen this kind of schematic representation on the CurePSP logo. I've used it for different reasons. And the reason why I used it really to drive home the message that while the classical presentation, which we now call Richardson syndrome, resides in the center of this syndrome, there are a lot of other clinical presentations. And I am not going to quiz you on all those acronyms, and I can promise you that my residents and my fellows would not remember them, but these highlight really the wide spectrum of the disease and the reason why in a number of cases it actually can be challenging for the clinician to give the accurate diagnosis. I've heard loud and clear from you in the morning that you said that it took a while to get the accurate diagnosis. It might not be just the diagnostic acumen of the clinician. That might be intrinsic spread or less typical presentation of the syndrome. So some of those are PSP postural instability, PSP presenting with predominantly freezing of gait, PSP presenting with predominantly Parkinsonian features, and some of these patients can respond well to Parkinson's medications. Levodopa is the most common of them. PSP with corticobasal syndrome presentation, PSP with the cerebellar features, which is very unusual and very difficult to put it in the category of PSP because majority of patients will not have that. PSP with the features of motor neuron disease, like ALS-like symptoms, PSP with predominant speech presentation, PSP with predominant frontotemporal presentation, so behavioral features. So you can see that the family is big, and some of the siblings, quote-unquote, in the family could carry much less traditional and typical presentation, which makes it complicated even for the experienced clinician to come up with ultimately correct diagnosis to be confirmed by pathology. So this is a simplified view of that spread diagram, which highlights the core features in the new diagnostic criteria. So obviously postural instability, balance problems, early falls, immediately the red flag that you're not dealing. And the reason why I'm coming back to Parkinson's disease again and again, because again, that is the more common condition. Clinicians are comfortable with that, right? So the red flags that immediately raise the question, no, I'm not dealing with this. I need to think about other spectrum disorders. So balance problems, early onset of falls, immediately should raise the question. We already talked about difficulty with eye movements and specifically with ability to look down. Akinesia, which is the Greek for inability to move, but it really encompasses slowness of movements in more broad term. And cognitive dysfunction is, again, you're well aware, can be a very significant part of the syndrome. So how did the group approach that? And again, I'm not going to walk you through complicated levels of evidence and the criteria and the bullet points that we need to put into the diagnosis, but it's important for you to recognize that when we arrive to the clinical diagnosis, and that specifically is relevant, it's important for the clinical care, and it is extremely important for us enrolling the right participants into the clinical trials. These new diagnostic criteria work through these core features of ocular motility dysfunction, so eye movement dysfunction, balance problems, akinesia, cognitive dysfunction, and provide specific examples and specific criteria based on which the clinician or clinician investigator will put the person in certain degree of diagnostic certainty. And as we already talked about, there are also supportive features, and those are reflected in the new diagnostic criteria. So people with, and those include the ones listed on the slide, so people with PSP by far and the most do not respond to Parkinson's medications, but, and that is highlighted out there, we'll talk more about that when we get to the management, very distinct pattern of speech that frequently is referred to as spastic dysarthria, again, different from the typical softness of the voice heard in people with Parkinson's disease. Swallowing problems, unfortunately, are a significant part of PSP-related disability. So all of those features can increase diagnostic certainty that you truly deal with that. So let's walk through the clinical features one by one so that when the clinician throws those terms, you understand what we mean. So vertical gaze palsy, to a certain degree, stands for the name. Vertical means vertical movement. Specifically, that's what we are looking for. But in more advanced stages of the disease, people would lose also ability to look horizontally. Slow velocity of the saccades, and again, those are all medical terms. So those can precede, and we frequently we have seen physicians pulling out what is called optokinetic tape. So a piece of cloth with vertical lines on them, because we're looking for more subtle evidence of eye movement dysfunction before we observe the obvious clear manifestation of vertical gaze palsy. The same is true for macro square wave jerks, and some of the patients will have difficulty opening their eyelids. So their eyes would stay closed, and when we ask them to open them, they have difficulty initiating that movement, not because the eyelids are weak, but it is the failure of connection of the command center from the cortical structures to the brain to the muscles that open the eyes, and again, can be part of the syndrome, and frequently would be misinterpreted as another condition that is called blepharospasm, which is involuntary increased closure of the eyes and can be treated very effectively with botulinum toxin injections. And a lot of patients will complain about difficulty looking at the bright light, what is called photophobia. So moving on, as I have said, the sine qua non of the syndrome, postural instability, difficulty with maintaining the balance due to the failure of the balance centers to provide that command. And when I'm saying balance centers, if you actually ask me, so where do those balance centers reside? We don't exactly know what is the anatomical one single spot, because balance is probably, balance and gait, aside from cognition, are probably our most complex functions of the nervous system. And you don't think about that, right? We've learned to walk at the age of one, and we've been walking ever since then. But multiple levels of the nervous system and different command centers go into that control of that very simple task, right, to make that step. So postural instability. In the new diagnostic criteria, the time frame has been moved. In the original diagnostic criteria, for the increasing the accuracy of the diagnosis, specifically for enrollment into clinical trials, the time frame was a year from onset. In the new diagnostic criteria, the time frame was increased to 3 years, specifically failure to control the balance and falling backwards. And again, for the families living with that condition, you know that. I don't need to tell you that. And you know that when you come to the neurologist, our traditional test is to pull someone backwards and to see whether they can resist us. And that's how we test postural stability in the clinical setting, short of putting someone on the postural control platform and getting some numbers more as objective assessment, which in clinical setting is not necessary and rarely is done. So what is under the rubric of akinesia, slowness of movements? So specifically in PSP syndrome, a subset of patients will have what we refer to as freezing of gait. Trouble with initiation of the movement, trouble with making the turn, getting stuck. And some, for some of the patients, I've highlighted that that might be the predominant feature of the syndrome. And then they're subcategorized in primary freezing of gait. So, and syndrome of Parkinsonism, we already covered that. But for people with PSP, we frequently refer to that as predominantly axial syndrome, for the reason of balance, for the reason of gait problems, and for majority of patients, but again, not for all, lack of tremor, definitely lack of the classical resting tremor, and lack of response to the Parkinson's medications. Cognitive dysfunction, one of the most challenging areas. Some of you called it out during the question and answer session today in the morning. So what would be the spectrum of cognitive manifestation? Speech, language disorders, which really span between the language and cognition. Non-fluent variant of progressive aphasia. Progressive apraxia, again, this failure of the control mechanisms to present our speech, as well as a wide spectrum of behavioral changes. So executive syndrome was already called out. Lack of initiative, apathy can be very prominent. Bradyphrenia, which stands for the slowness of our cognitive responses. And again, you've asked the question, how much should we recognize that there is cognitive dysfunction? The person might comprehend, but has just difficulty processing the information. So I absolutely agree with Fair on the side the person understands and have the conversation with the person appropriately. This executive syndrome, specifically difficulty with multitasking, difficulty with sequencing events, difficulty with collating all the information that is coming in into one response. And that can be very challenging in day-to-day interaction with a person because you think that you've given the clear command, right? But the person just have difficulty processing that information. Impulsivity, disinhibition, all of these can be in the spectrum of the syndrome, and those would be more frontotemporal, kind of frontotemporal behavioral spectrum disorder and can be very troubling for the person and for the families. So, and then other clinical features, corticobasal syndrome. I will talk more about that, and I know that there are some of the families here with CBD, so we'll have more of the conversation on that. So, what is corticobasal syndrome? You remember that I started the discussion with a description of Parkinsonism as a syndrome. So, this is another syndrome. Corticobasal syndrome is not a diagnosis. It is constellation of clinical features. So what are those clinical features? So it's combination of clinical symptoms that reflect cortical dysfunction, right? So the highest level of the brain, extrapyramidal dysfunction. So those are the basal ganglia that are responsible for Parkinsonian features. And within the spectrum of the cortical dysfunction, it can be full-blown dementia. It can be asymmetric, more on one side. When we talk about corticobasal syndrome compared to classical presentation of PSP, when we talk about midline symptoms, with corticobasal syndrome, it is asymmetric syndrome. The features are much more pronounced on one side of the body, be that slowness of movements, be that rigidity, be that involuntary jerking of the muscles, what is called myoclonus, be that loss of ability to perceive the sensory stimulation, and that is what is called corticosensory loss. Focal limb dystonia, stiffness that is very pronounced on one side of the body. So when we think about corticobasal syndrome, all of those are the features that are much more pronounced on one side of the body. So that's the syndrome. So what is different between corticobasal syndrome and corticobasal degeneration? So compared to the syndrome, which can be driven by a number of different pathological entities, including Alzheimer's disease, including Lewy body disease, including progressive supranuclear palsy, corticobasal degeneration is pathology-based diagnosis. So that's the distinction. We can say that I see the features that are consistent with corticobasal syndrome, but I'm really not sure what is driving the underlying pathology. And when the pathologist comes back and says, I see tau pathology in these particular structures, that's what moves it from the syndrome to the clinical pathological entity of corticobasal degeneration. I understand that that is confusing because the terms are very similar, but it's important to understand. And again, driving it back to the statement that pathology confirmation is essential. And actually, Dr. Beauvais was the first author on the publication reviewing the spectrum of the clinical manifestations that can be seen in the spectrum of corticobasal syndrome, and he already has covered some of the imaging features of PSP. So these are the features that would be helpful for us in diagnosis of corticobasal syndrome. Asymmetric loss of cortical structures, you can see. For some reason, my pointer is not projecting well. So this is the structural imaging. This is MRI. This is the functional imaging, which is FDG PET scan, looking for asymmetric loss of metabolic signal. But unfortunately, again, if we see those, they help us with the diagnosis, but we don't always see them on our imaging studies. So again, we get back to our clinical acumen. So returning back to the diagnostic criteria, and I know that this is a busy slide, but it gives you the summary, again, of the spectrum of different phenotypic presentations of progressive supranuclear palsy, and drives back home the message that the diagnosis can be difficult, and diagnosis might not be apparent, especially early in the course of the disease, until someone manifests the full spectrum of the typical manifestations. So Dr. Beauvais has already reviewed how much imaging can help us. And imaging definitely is a very important tool, and every patient presenting with the conditions in that spectrum will be asked to have an MRI scan. What are we looking for? In PSP, we are looking for atrophy of the midbrain, and he's shown you this hummingbird sign, and it is here. I am showing you the same structures, but showing you the axial slices like this through the brain, and we're looking for what frequently is called the Mickey Mouse sign, because there is atrophy of the midbrain here, which makes the cerebral peduncles stand out on the imaging, and we also can measure that anterior-posterior diameter, and there are some numbers that are associated and seen in PSP. But again, if we see those signs, they're very helpful, but we don't always see them on the imaging of people who ultimately have confirmed diagnosis of PSP. And then in the same issue of the movement disorders, there was also the summary of the radiological features that I associated with a diagnosis of PSP. And considering that Dr. Bove has already covered some of the imaging, I don't want to spend too much time on that, but just to give you a very brief overview. So this is the imaging that gives us the readout of preservation of dopaminergic system in the brain. And just visually, this is how the normal brain, the healthy brain looks like. This is how the brain of anyone who has loss of production of dopamine in the brain, not specific for Parkinson's disease, not specific for PSP, not specific for CBD. So all of those conditions, what they have in common is loss of the neurons that produce dopamine, and we can have the readout on the imaging studies. Those are, for clinical purposes, they are read as normal, abnormal. In the research domain, we actually can have the quantitative assessment. But again, as I have said, that study does not help us with differentiation of what syndrome is driving that deficiency. It all falls under one umbrella. There was already discussion about tau imaging, extremely important, especially as we are stepping into pathology-based experimental therapeutics that all of us are so excited about. So I will not cover this, and we'll move on to another slide, and again, very, very busy slide, but providing you the summary of the imaging criteria that we're put into the publication. Again, driving home the complexity of the diagnosis and the challenges of the diagnosis. So now from the diagnosis, let's move on to the next most important, one of the most frequently asked questions in the clinic. So you're giving me this diagnosis, you're giving us as a family this diagnosis. What is the life expectancy? And a lot of patients, so this is the data that again comes from 2017 publication that reviewed, that is the meta-analysis of the publications over the large span from 1997 going even back to 1986, right? And this is what is called the survival curve, right? So from multiple publications, on the vertical line is cumulative survival in years, and this is percent of the survival, right? So it is true that for the mean, if you take the large group and if you look at the most common, it is true that on average it falls somewhere around 7 years. But I want to point your attention to this tail, and the tail goes as far as 24 years. So I really want to drive home the message, at least in my practice, the patients come in with that statement, and one of the first questions is, I've read about those 7 years, where am I, how much I have left? And every single one of us as clinicians really communicates the message that the course of the disease is extremely individual, and I really cannot, these numbers are very important numbers for the group. Those are very important numbers for research. But I cannot plot one person on that curve and say, this is exactly the number that I'm giving you. And to, again, support those numbers, first of all, these are the variables in the clinical features of the disease that are associated with predictors of less unfavorable predictors of survival for PSP. Richardson syndrome that we've already discussed is the classical phenotype of PSP with predominant postural instability and gaze dysfunction. That's where the numbers came from, early onset of swallowing problems, early onset of cognitive dysfunction, early falls, overall disease severity score. So makes sense, right? So these are the clinical variables that I associated with shorter course of the disease. And again, very recent publication, so you can see that the literature has been quite, that researchers have been quite active, and the literature has had a number of publications truly dating to 2017. So this is another publication in that conglomerate of diagnostic features, imaging features, and now what clinical features that we see as clinicians carry the highest predictive value of the accuracy of the diagnosis. But I want to draw your attention to this column, which is progressive supranuclear palsy, which is the number of patients that had actually pathology examination, who passed and whose brain was examined. And that's what the numbers are based on. Average age of onset is 66, though a significant spread from 40 to 90. I don't know whether you can see that number over here. Age of death, average 74, but again, a very significant spread. And disease duration from the time of onset of the symptoms to someone passing, the average 7.9. But again, really what I want to drive home the message, a very significant spread with a tail going as far as 27 years. I never want to be over-optimistic, but I absolutely don't want to be over-pessimistic, and I want to repeat the message that it truly is individual course of the disease for every person who is stepping into our clinic. And to wrap up the discussion of the diagnosis, how do we make the diagnosis? I think that all of us speaking through the course of the morning have communicated to you that as of today, short of pathology confirmation, it is a clinical diagnosis based on the history, based on the clinic, a careful exam of the person. We do use the imaging modalities to help us with diagnostic accuracy, but still it comes back to the clinical acumen and frequently to the duration of the follow-up of the person. And now let's move on to the spectrum of clinical manifestations and what can we do and how can we help. So I have put together this another busy slide, and the reason why I'm doing that to drive home the message of the complexity of the clinical manifestations of the disease. And for a lot of you, I don't need to tell you that. You're living that every day. But under those rubrics of the major syndromes of postural instability, of cognitive dysfunction, of ocular motility dysfunction, there are a lot of symptoms which, depending on the person, can be more or less troublesome for them. So, how can we help? Unfortunately, we don't have disease-specific therapies as of today, and we frequently will try Parkinson medications. For majority of patients, they will not be effective. We sometimes will try, and if that's the case, we will not use them continuously because what's the point, right? And our readout of the efficacy. Frequently will be just the clinical interview of the person. Have they helped? Have they not helped? What are the side effects? Amantadine, which is another Parkinson medication which doesn't have evidence but has some clinical observation, can be helpful for gait dysfunction, might be tried, and everything else is management of the symptoms. So now we are moving into the discussion of supportive care that is extremely important. So Jacqueline has shown me a sign that I have to be wrapping up, but I think that my next slides on non-pharmacological management are extremely important to the audience, and with her permission, I would rather go through them and probably leave a little bit less time for myself for the questions and answers. So multidisciplinary care, the word that was heard by you from a number of speakers, and Diane Breslow is in the audience, and I have to say that I use some of her slides and appreciate those. She used to be our social worker for a number of years at our center at Northwestern. So this is the slide that you probably will see in her presentation as well, but I cannot reinforce more the importance of the team care. And that's what you should be seeking. And that's what you should be looking for. Obviously, it's neurologist who has experience in management of the disease, but it is your whole team of the other experts that are contributing to the management of the disease for the person and for the family. And I will quickly go through all the domains that need to be addressed to translate it into the best management of quality of life until the moment we have effective curative therapies. And Diane will be talking more about the role of the social worker, so I'm quickly skipping through those slides, but really driving home the message that it's extremely important, even if it is a commute, to find the team that can provide you that care, ideally under one roof. And a number of centers, obviously, that have expertise in taking care of patients with these conditions, neurologists, your rehab team, and rehab team that has expertise and experience in managing patients with different manifestations of Parkinsonian syndromes. We are fortunate at Northwestern to have Rehab Institute, which now Shirley Ryan, Ability Center on our premises, that has a dedicated team of physiatrists, physical therapists, occupational therapists, speech therapists, all contributing to the patient's care. So what would each individual do? Nurses are extremely important because this is the front line of your communication with the center. They will advise on medication side effects, respond to the phone calls, and really coordinate overall care. Physical therapist, you've asked a lot of questions about, as I don't need to tell you, that postural instability, one of the most debilitating symptoms, and we don't have drugs for that. So counseling on safety, counseling on mobility assistance devices, advising on the right walker, advising on the right wheelchair when it's necessary, all of that is essential in the care of the patients. Occupational therapists who will contribute to the care, again, with evaluation of the home safety, evaluation of the adaptive devices in the house. How do I get out of the chair? How do I get out of bed? How do I turn in bed? How do I maneuver safely around the kitchen? So all of those questions sound like mundane questions, but extremely important in day-to-day life of individuals. Speech therapist, we talked a lot about speech impairment, about swallowing dysfunction, so that's what will be addressed by the speech therapist. Maximizing compensatory strategies and advising on communication devices when it's necessary. And along with that, doing the assessment of the swallowing function, and again, maximizing compensatory strategies and, when necessary, advising on pros and cons of feeding tube placement. Nutritionist, as the swallowing function declines, how can we compensate for that? How can we provide the nutrition safely with reducing the risk of swallowing function this way? And I cannot speak more about the role of the social worker, really pulling together all the resources that are available, advising the families, advising the caregivers, very much focusing on the caregiver strain and burden. All of that is essential in the management, and Diane will talk more about that. And the last but not the least, again, it's no secret to you that it is a progressive neurodegenerative condition, and at some point the discussion of end of life has to happen, and we urge to have that discussion early on when the person has cognitive capacity to make the decisions, to express their wishes, so that we are respectful of them. And more movement disorders centers around the country are establishing dedicated palliative care programs, including us at Northwestern, where the patients and the families are given the opportunity to meet with a team, to sit down with a team, to have the conversation not only with the neurologist, social worker, with clergy, with a palliative care physician, truly to have the plan in place, to respect the dignity, and to have the plan in place so that it's not decided at the point of crisis. And with that, I will close up that I wish someday we will say that we have a pill, an infusion, or effective, definitive therapy. But until we have that holistic approach to management, focusing on the quality of life is really the focus of our management. And I want to close really with the same statement that all the previous speakers have said, that the horizon is optimistic, and really to drive home the message, this is the snapshot of clinicaltrials.gov website with a number of clinical trials being done in progressive supranuclear palsy and related disorders, and the numbers are climbing. So again, that horizon is optimistic, and I want you really take that message home. And in the interim, seek the programs that can provide you holistic care to the people and the families. Thank you. Yes.
Okay, my wife passed away from PSP about 2 years ago, roughly, and first she was diagnosed with multiple sclerosis. We went through that a year, then a year and a half of Parkinson's. About in her third year of the disease, she was diagnosed with PSP. She had the eye movement, the leaning to the left, falling back to the right, but one of the things that they used, which I haven't heard yet tonight, was when she sat down and stood up, her blood pressure would drop between 10 to 20 points. And she was in a couple trials. I took her to every doctor all around. But during one of the trials, they monitored her for sitting and getting in and out of bed, and her blood pressure would drop 20 points when she stood up. And that was one of the symptoms that they said was for PSP. I'm wondering if that's still...
So what you're describing is called orthostatic hypotension. Drop of the blood pressure with standing up, which is manifestation of dysfunction of autonomic nervous system, which is involved in a number of in this family of neurodegenerative conditions, but much more in multiple systems atrophy, and to a lesser extent, but also significantly in Parkinson's disease, driven by different pathology. So we are talking a lot about tau protein. In those conditions, it's alpha-synuclein, much less common in PSP. I'm not saying that cannot happen, but much less common in PSP. It's bright, so I don't see where the hands are.
First of all, that was an excellent presentation. Particularly the part about the multidisciplinary approach. My wife had PSP. I was caregiver for 8 years. And one of the things you didn't mention that we found of tremendous value was hospice. And hospice wasn't the end of life. We had hospice for well over 2 years. And they formed as part of the team. And they would come in with the nurse. That was just part of it. There was a lady who would come in once a week and wash my wife and do her hair, put her makeup on, things I could never do. The big problem there was she left a pile of towels you wouldn't believe. But but I lived with that. But the support we got from them through the whole thing was enormous. A second point is end of life. My wife reached a point where she couldn't speak. And she didn't speak for a year. Then one night, we were in bed, and she rolled over and she said, "I want to go home. Are you okay?" Out of nowhere. Never spoke again after that. She waited 4 days for my son to get there, saw him, and 2 hours later, she passed away. So my question is, is there a part of this where someone can actually will their time?
So the first comment, and it's not a question, it's a comment, cannot agree with you more. So I cover hospice under the more broader umbrella of palliative care. And again, would strongly encourage the families to have that conversation early on and to have the plan of care. And it's not that we are black ravens telling you that the time is running out. It is having the plan, the roadmap, that is so he has to be comforting, and he has to give the notion that you are in control. You as a patient, you as a family. The second point, I just did not get the last part of the sentence.
Bottom line, after nowhere, she had the ability to speak, but she only spoke those few words. But total clarity of mind. So my question is, it seemed to me that she just either reached a point where she had nothing left to fight with, and she just basically picked her time. And I'd like your comments on that.
I don't have the answer to that. God does. So anarthria, inability to speak, can be part of the disease manifestations. You know, there is a phenomenon of time of flight when advanced people with Parkinson's disease, seeing the fire, got up and ran and never were able to do that again. Whether that is the comparison to that, but don't have the answer and probably will never have one.
My question is about physical therapy, occupational speech therapy, specifically for PSP. Is there research being done on methods or techniques that are more intentional for helping PSP patients have stronger and better lives until we do get a cure? Or is it just any general physical or occupational therapy that you think is beneficial?
So there are two questions there. There is one, clinical care, right? And clinical care, no, it's not general physical therapy. It has to be geared towards disability, right? And obviously, if balance is the major issue, it has to be geared towards compensation as much as it can be, and we are always very clear to the patients that we cannot fix your balance. We can do our best to prevent recurrent falling, right? Research, probably more under the general rubric of Parkinsonian syndromes rather than specifically focused on PSP in the domain of rehabilitation services, but definitely more needs to be done.
I have been diagnosed by doctors at for confirmed by Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota. My question to you is, he put me on Levakova, whatever it is, Carvedova, 2 years. Can I go off it now? It don't seem to help at all. Can I just go off it now? Don't help me at all.
So first of all, disclaimer, none of us can make individual recommendations without sitting down with a person, knowing the history, examining the person. Okay. So refrain from any specific recommendations. That's really a question to your treating physician.
Okay.
I'm taking the medication. Is it doing anything for me? Is it not doing anything for me? And depending on the response to that decision process of tapering the medication.
I have a couple of questions. So one is about dysarthria. Can you talk a little bit about how it manifests? Is it typical, or is there a spectrum of difficulty to speech? You know, the kind of difficulty they have. And second thing is the fall risk. Is it always common in PSP patients, or can there be a fall risk in some patients and not in other patients?
Okay, so both very valid questions, right? So dysarthria, which is speech impairment, right? That's the translation of the word. The typical term that is used for the description of speech in people with PSP is spastic dysarthria, more of the strangled speech. It can have a dystonic component. As I have initially alluded to, it's not the classical soft spoken voice of people with Parkinson's disease. And in some of them, it definitely can be a very progressive phenomena, and some of the patients will lose the ability to verbally communicate, which is called anarthria, but all of that is on the spectrum. So again, fairly generic response, but without individual person, this is all within the spectrum and the standard deviation. In regard to the falls, as you've seen in the slides, postural instability is one of the required symptoms for the diagnosis of classical phenotype of PSP, which now is referred to Richardson syndrome. Could there be patients with more behavioral variant of the disease, with more speech and language impairment variant of the disease? Yes, there could be. And that's what that busy diagram of different phenotypes, different presentations of the syndrome was. But for the classical syndrome, that is part of the disease.
That was an excellent presentation. Thank you so much. I don't believe we have copies of your slides, and I'm hoping we can get copies. They aren't at the table. Super.
It probably was because I was tardy.
That's okay. No, we're glad you showed up. My husband has severe postural instability, and he tried L-DOPA for several months and didn't see any results. You were kind of rushing there, and you mentioned something called amantadine. Could you say more about that?
First of all, amantadine is one of the medications approved for management of Parkinson's disease. And we frequently refer to it as a dirty drug because it has different neurotransmitter pathways of action. So first of all, disclaimer, there is no evidence, it's clinical experience. And the clinical experience is that for some patients it can be beneficial for freezing of gait. So that's the statement. It strictly to the discussion between the patient and the physician whether that's something that will be tried or not. I don't know what Dr. Beauvais' experience is. And it seems like he's holding the microphone.
Agree. I was going to ask you a question, though. Wait a second. Tanya, great presentation. And forgive me, I had to walk out, but could you explain a little bit more of the Richardson syndrome? We're going to hear this term more and more now that it's becoming ingrained, and a lot of people may not be that familiar with it.
So that is the term that is applied to the classical presentation of PSP, which is postural instability and eye movement dysfunction. Right, and we had a couple slides covering that. But again, driving home the message is more and more recognition that when we have the pathology, this is the syndrome, that we have very good grasp on the clinical diagnosis, and in majority of cases, we will be right. But it is all the other phenotypes that we have much more challenge giving the name of PSP, and that's where there is discrepancy between the clinician's diagnosis and ultimate pathology diagnosis. Is that the... Okay. Thank you very much.